Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents When Money Talks, A History of Coins and Numismatics by Frank L. Holt, narrated by Walter Dixon. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and plates present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. I did not go into history for the money. I went into money for the history. I learned long ago that money in general, and coins in particular, can furnish enormous amounts of information about the development of world civilizations. As a historian of ancient Greece and Rome, I often rely upon coins in my work, because other less durable sources have vanished. Most of the monetary artifacts discussed in this book have survived for many centuries, and they will likely endure for many more. That is a record unrivaled by papyrus, paper, and parchment. Coins are perhaps the most successful information technology ever devised. It would be foolish to ignore it. The study of coins in this way is called numismatics, and those who collect, curate, and investigate coins and related objects are called numismatists. These terms are not widely known, and even less familiar are the many achievements associated with them. The public deserves a broader knowledge of numismatics and numismatists. To make that case, I applied to the National Endowment for the Humanities for a public scholar program grant. Such funds support the production of well-researched books written in a style that appeals to a large audience of general listeners. The goal is not for one scholar to communicate with other experts, but for a researcher to engage the public in the exploration of a subject that may be neglected or poorly understood. I was fortunate enough to receive the grant, and I acknowledge most gratefully the opportunity it afforded me to complete this project. Of course, all findings and views expressed in this book are my own and do not necessarily reflect those of the National Endowment for the Humanities. I acknowledge also the work of a class book completion grant from the University of Houston and the kind assistance of the American Numismatics Society in the acquisition of illustrations. I have benefited a great deal from the advice and support of many learned colleagues, especially Professors Stanley Burstein and Carol Thomas, who supported my application to the NEH. For archaeological, archival, and numismatic assistance and inspiration over the years, I humbly acknowledge Carmen Arnold Bucci, Paul Bernard, Osman Boparachi, Olivier Bordeaux, Lee Bryce, Pierre Cambon, Alexis Castor, Christina Camerati, Francois Ducalatai, Richard Doty, Nigora Dvorachenskaya, Stephen Ellis, Cynthia Freeland, Gerard Fussman, Oliver Gorse, William Graves, Philip Grierson, Francis Joseph, Julian Leslie, Charlotte Maxwell Jones, Alexander Neymark, Valery Nikonorov, Robert Palmer, Clifton Potter, Mohamed Fahim Rahimi, Edvard Ritvaladze, Tara Sewell Lassiter, and Peter Van Alphen. None of these persons should be held responsible for my errors or interpretations. I wish to thank Oxford University Press and its excellent editorial and production staff. I am especially grateful to Executive Editor Stefan Vranka for his inexhaustible wisdom and good humor. I thank also Senior Production Editor Melissa Yanuzzi for her contributions to this project. The recommendations of several of the press's outside readers proved invaluable, and I acknowledge most humbly the learned and helpful comments of Dr. Liv Yarrow, Associate Professor of Classics at Brooklyn College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. I began writing this book 18 months ago in a different world. Back then, I could still see well enough to read books on my own, and the word coronavirus was not yet on everyone's lips. My ability to work through these times of literal darkness and lockdown has been made possible by one person to whom I dedicate this book. She has been my eyes, editor, reader, driver, and steadfast companion. I hope this book is worthy of what Linda has meant to me since our first date 50 years ago. Houston, Texas, May 2020. 1. Introduction. The Congress shall have power to coin money. U.S. Constitution, Article 1, Section 8. Johnny's Cash. Every one of us carries around a pocket guide to world history and culture. Thumbing through a wallet of bills is like paging through a textbook. Sorting coins seems like scrolling through tiny disks of information technology crammed with words and images. In America today, Johnny cannot pay cash for so much as a soda without connecting his present to a long and eventful past, filled with important people, patriotic slogans, a profession of faith, historic events, symbols of power, and even the dead language of ancient Rome. He may imagine that he is simply completing a transaction in order to quench his thirst. But a great deal more is going on every time we involve ourselves with cash. Perhaps Johnny has never read his money or examined its account of his history and cultural identity. Maybe Johnny, and his sister Jane too, think of their money as only a means to an end. Perhaps Johnny is not aware that his pockets and Jane's purse harbor the historic relics of many American milestones, including a great constitutional crisis that arose during the Civil War. In fact, the money he spent for his soda may have saved the Union and kept united the states into which he was born. To coin, a phrase. In 1862, Commander-in-Chief Abraham Lincoln learned firsthand that war exhausts wealth as wastefully as it does human life. The crippling costs of the Civil War could not be met by the nation's traditional reliance upon coinage, forcing the President and Congress to test the limits of the Constitution by issuing as legal tender the federal government's first paper currency. Called greenbacks because of the distinctive ink used to thwart counterfeiters, this money made Union victory possible, but remained in doubt as a legitimate exercise of congressional power. It required 3 Supreme Court cases after the war to settle the matter, the first declaring the action unconstitutional and the others upholding the government's right to print as well as to mint money. This turning point in American history rested in part on a fairly simple question. What does the word coin mean? The constitutional issue before the Supreme Court was whether the verb necessarily intends the noun. Until the monetary crisis of 1862, Congress had acted as though it did by authorizing only a metallic currency, such as a gold federal dollar. Yet, money has a remarkable and restless history, anchored in the past, but anxious for the future. Green has therefore gained a place alongside gold. Money may no longer be metal alone. That explains why people today can find in their pockets and purses an homage to Lincoln, minted not only onto a 1 cent metallic coin, but also printed onto a $5 bill. Both are now money, both currency, and both coined with constitutional authority in a nation saved in part by the expansive interpretation of a single word. At this very moment, money is on the move again, exploring the digital depths of cyberspace and testing the meanings of coin once more. What, after all, is a Bitcoin, Litecoin, Bitcoin, Insane Coin, New Coin, Swift Coin, or Dogecoin? These are just a few of the many new cryptocurrencies based on blockchain technology. The inventors of this innovative money seek a profound break from the world's long reliance upon physical cash. They are boldly challenging millennia of monetary convention. Yet, they seem reluctant to think outside the cash box when naming their creations. Bitcoins, after all, are not a bit like coins. And only with the loosest language are such currencies said to be mined. We are once again expanding what can be considered money, currency, and coinage by mining money, not made of metals, and coining intangible computer code. Cryptocurrencies remind us that the money of tomorrow can never be anticipated today. Even so, coined money, in its original form of stamped metals, is likely to endure this challenge. After all, confidence in cryptocurrency has already been shaken by the untimely death of one of its champions, Gerald Cotton, CEO of Quadriga CX, who took to his grave the password to $190 million worth of other people's money. When this wealth vanished, Cotton's 115,000 customers could recover only a small portion of their money, notably in the form of tangible assets surrendered by Quadriga. Hard cash has some real advantages over crypto coins. In the words of celebrity entrepreneur Mark Cuban, "Nobody thinks cash is going away. Even the Bitcoin freaks don't think cash is going away." Coinage has already withstood the creation of paper currency, checkbooks, and credit cards. It will likely survive the 2020 COVID-19 pandemic as well, even though fears of the contagion prompted some municipalities to ban cash payments at toll booths and other locations. Previously, researchers tracking the movements of money to understand how pandemics spread from place to place had already discovered that coins themselves are part of the problem. A study of coins circulating in Nairobi identified on them potentially pathogenic bacteria and fungi being carried from person to person. Nevertheless, just as the coronavirus reached the United States, New York City followed San Francisco and Philadelphia in promoting a ban on cashless businesses on the grounds that rejecting cash payments discriminates against the financially vulnerable. Coins exemplify a new reality: the medico-economic clash between facilitating commerce and fighting contagious diseases. In some ways, coins have been advantaged by the virus. The modern myth of the cashless society has a long history. In March 1963, as a publicity stunt for the film The Man from the Diners Club, Columbia Pictures, an obituary appeared in the Winsted Evening Citizen titled "Cash Died Today." It read in part, "Cash, which was born several thousand years ago, the son of barter, the adopted child of trade, died today in Winsted, Connecticut, a small American city on the banks of the Mad River." The announcement turned out to be an ad man's delight, but the corpse walked out of the morgue and remains very much alive today. The amount of American cash in circulation has rapidly increased since 1963, with values measured now in the trillions. Money, coins, currency. The protean concept of money keeps evolving. Originally, the terms money and its cognates, monetize, monetary, mint, mintage, derived from the name of the Roman goddess Juno Moneta, whose image appears on some ancient coins, along with the tools used to manufacture coins. The appellation moneta stems from the Latin monere, meaning to warn, based on ancient legends that the goddess Juno alerted the Romans to approaching dangers. Since it was at her temple that the Romans operated their first mint, money, in its original sense, is the product of striking metals into coins. As a noun, the English term coin can be traced back to the Old French coin, denoting the wedge-shaped die used to stamp the metal. This sense of coin derived in turn from the Latin cuneus, meaning a wedge, as in cuneiform, the term describing the wedge-shaped writing impressed onto the clay tablets of ancient Mesopotamia. The lessons to be learned are fundamental. While all coins are money, not all money is now coinage, even though the law allows every type of U.S. federal money to be coined. All money is not necessarily currency, meaning that some of it, coins included, may cease to be legal tender for all debts, public and private. An ancient Greek drachma is money and coin, but no longer currency. A $10 Federal Reserve note is money and currency, but not a coin. Even a woodpecker scalp or a cigarette can become current money under the right conditions. All coined in a sense, but not all coins. In 17th century Canada, for example, settlers without cash turned playing cards into currency when no governmental solution was at hand. In Germany, after World War I, hyperinflation compelled distressed communities to print their own emergency money, Notgeld, on aluminum foil, silk, and pieces of wood. During the Vietnam War, the United States Department of Defense issued its own paper scrip for service personnel. A similar monetary system, based on cardboard chips, exists today for the benefit of troops stationed in Afghanistan. In 1961, the British Royal Mint experimented with the production of a plastic coin, which never became currency. In 2014, the breakaway nation of Transnistria, near the Black Sea, issued the world's first circulating plastic coinage in four geometric shapes aglow in different luminous colors. Germany has produced a 5-euro coin with an embedded plastic ring designed to thwart counterfeiters. The color of the ring identifies the issuing mint. We often say figuratively that money talks, but in Mongolia, the phrase may be taken literally. The 2007 Mongolian 502-grit coin displays a portrait of John F. Kennedy and plays a short recording from the statesman's famous 1963 speech from West Berlin, all at the push of a tiny button. These limited edition coins sold quicker than the collectors could say, "Ich bin ein Berliner." Commodities such as tea, rum, chewing gum, and animal hides have also been popular forms of money at one time or another. The Finnish word for money, raha, originated as the medieval term for squirrel pelts. Similarly, a buck in American money was once an actual buckskin marketed by fur trappers. Our word salary derives from the Latin salarium, a Roman soldier's ration of salt. Hence, to be worth your salt means worthy of what you are being paid. Native American money once consisted of shells strung together as wampum, perhaps contributing to the phrase shell out cash, still used today. When we say that money does not grow on trees, we forget the ingenious Mesoamericans. Early European explorers marveled that inhabitants of the New World valued cacao over gold and used it as money. One 16th century chronicler wrote, "I am well aware that people of feeble imagination will accuse me of being fantastic when I speak of trees bearing money." He named it happy money and extolled its pleasures. You and I cannot drink our money like a Mayan noble, but we can mysteriously convert pieces of paper, plastic, cheap alloyed metals, or digital code into a steaming cup of cocoa. Cattle and other living creatures have served as currency since the earliest domestication of flocks for food and farming. The Romans called wealth in general pecunia, believing that it derived from pecus, livestock. This explains our English term pecuniary. Likewise, we speak of the poor as being impecunious, which is to say, cowless, in the same way that Texans describe someone pretending to be rich as all hat and no cattle. When we say capital in a monetary sense, the term has links to chattel and cattle. Our word fee harkens back to livestock in Old English. As a result, livestock wanders through our financial markets whenever someone raises capital, pays fees, or satisfies other pecuniary needs. Money has often been a living thing, and it might even, in some cultures, have a soul. The Kisi money of West Africa is a notable example. First fashioned in the late 19th century from twisted iron rods, this currency sported an ear, ling, at one end, and a foot, kodo, at the other. If a rod broke, it lost all value and could not circulate as currency unless properly healed by a shaman. This ritual restored the money's escaped soul and rendered it potent again. Kisi money was eventually abolished as currency by European colonialists, but it remains in use for ceremonial rites. A belief in the spiritual qualities of coinage persists in many forms, such as its burial and votive deposits, people's claims of communicating with the dead through found coins, the placing of good luck pennies in penny loafers, the tossing of money into wishing wells, and the arrangement of bundled coins in feng shui. The so-called coin trees of the British Isles provide another interesting example, as shown in Figure 1.8. Hundreds of these trees, stumps, and logs have been embedded with thousands of coins hammered into them over the past 3 centuries. Most of this activity is recent and represents an ongoing evolution. Originally, the coins were left to promote ritual healing, but the practice continues as simple mimicry by passers-by, unfamiliar with the history of the coin trees, but loath not to participate, lest ill fortune befall them. Magic and mystery. In its myriad forms, then, money functions as a complex mental construct that may at any moment transcend its economic role by serving as additional spiritual, political, ceremonial, or judicial needs. Money is a nearly universal concept, though conspicuously constrained by cultural conditions, so that one person's money may be another's ordinary pack of gum. These traits render money delightfully enigmatic and magical beyond the scope of most other items associated with everyday life. If magic is the belief that ordinary things wield extraordinary powers to influence events in mysterious ways, then what need have we for wands and wizards? Sorcery already endows an otherwise useless metal disc or plastic card with the awesome power to conjure a meal or dissolve a debt. Why else do so many of us believe in assets we cannot see or touch, trusting in the alchemy of cyber accounts to produce the essentials of life? What do the strange spells and symbols mean that empower one humble object over another, whether Decus et Tutamen, an ornament and safeguard with a winged dragon in Britain, or in America, Anuit Cheptis, he has approved our undertakings, with a disembodied eyeball peeping over an unfinished pyramid? When Harry Potter's ill-tempered uncle locks him in a cupboard and brazenly declares, "There's no such thing as magic," he has forgotten his own pounds and pence. Wherever pockets and purses bulge with bills or jingle with coins, there are no muggles. For to purchase anything with money is to practice magic. The great irony is that Uncle Vernon's everyday cash is far more enchanted than the wizarding currency of Harry Potter. The vaults at Gringotts allegedly hold coins made of fine gold, galleons, silver, sickles, and bronze, canuts, things that carry value whether coined or not. On the other hand, Vernon's paper money has power based solely upon his blind faith in a kind of economic abracadabra. Some experts call the latter fiat money because its purchasing power derives from nothing more than an officious pronouncement that makes it so. Fiat, in Latin, commands, "Let it be done." Our word credit goes back to another Latin verb, credire, meaning to believe or trust. When a store clerk asks Vernon, "Cash or credit?" to settle his bill, the truth is that his cash is credit. He no longer hands over anything of intrinsic worth for his gas and groceries. Uncle Vernon's magic money, like Lincoln's first greenbacks, may be traced back to a monetary revolution begun in 10th century China. The Chinese had been lugging around lots of base metal coins, called literally cash, a burden lifted when the bearers of imperial paper script could henceforth cash in their notes for the stated amount of coins. When Marco Polo traveled to China in the 13th century, he marveled that Kublai Khan had convinced people to buy and sell everything, even gold, silver, and jewels, using only pieces of paper. This currency baffled the European so much that he called the great Khan an alchemist. It therefore took centuries for this kind of money to gain currency in Western countries, because people there needed reassurance that they could actually redeem paper currency for coins, which to them meant primarily gold and silver. Hence, from 1878 to 1963, the silver certificates popular in America as paper money bore a solemn promise in bold letters that the bearer could claim on demand real silver in exchange for the note. That promise has long since been rescinded, of course. In Uncle Sam, we trust that a $100 bill has greater value than a $1 note, even though, materially, they are indistinguishable. Money works only because we trust that it will. An act of profound faith, whether we are relying upon Bitcoin, cacao beans, or credit cards. That is why the subject of money fascinates philosophers, anthropologists, moralists, and historians no less than it does economists. We accept money's contradictions and ironies to an almost laughable degree, and we seek its power to a lamentable one. Religious leaders collect and spend vast sums of it to warn against collecting and spending vast sums of it. If you make it in your business, you are commended. If you make it in your basement, you are arrested. We call it bread, cabbage, clams, bacon, biscuits, cheddar, gravy, and dough, but almost none of it could be mistaken for food. Broke means you have no money. Broker means you probably do. You can use money to do your laundry, but you'd better not launder your money. Your bottom dollar puts you in the poorhouse, but a pretty penny buys you a mansion. You can use money to grease someone's palm or pay through the nose. so why would you ever put it where your mouth is? The point is that money is so embedded within our culture that we seldom notice these ironies. As the poet D.H. Lawrence observed, money is our madness, our vast collective madness. It is ironic, too, that in the United States, a child may buy a pencil in the school store using money that declares on her behalf an unequivocal faith in God, yet that public school cannot openly acknowledge the same deity in organized prayer. Her coins display the slogan, Liberty, beside the portraits of two presidents, Washington and Jefferson, who enslaved other human beings. And the only private residence in American history that she sees on a coin is an old slave plantation. She may speak any of the 350 languages tracked by the U.S. Census Bureau, but only two of them, English and Italian, appear on her coins. A third language, Latin, probably perplexes her when she reads E Pluribus Unum on her money. She may never in her life know what it means, from many, one. Or appreciate the significance in the number of letters spelling it, 13, in reference to the 13 original colonies. Her parents may wonder why President Andrew Jackson, who opposed paper currency, appears on their $20 bills. That, and more seriously, his record on slavery and the treatment of Native Americans has set in motion a popular movement to have Jackson removed altogether from U.S. currency. Some impatient Americans have been using a rubber stamp to replace the face of Jackson with that of Harriet Tubman. Design and conquer. For many years, I have challenged university students to redesign the currency that makes each of us a walking encyclopedia of American history and culture. Students, having different preferences for the national symbols, heroes, ideologies, and milestones that should be promoted for the future, are free to choose them. Together, we justify any changes proposed for current coinage. The outcome is sometimes surprising and always revealing. One undergraduate stamped her new mintage with the motto, We the People, then replaced the figures of famous leaders with a mirrored surface so that users would literally see themselves on the coins. Classmates heartily approved the coin's built-in message of diversity. Others have replaced liberty with bywords from their own generations, ranging over the decades from peace and love to tolerance and respect. The Latin phrase e pluribus unum always loses out, most recently to hashtag me too, although one student compromised with a Latinized version, hashtag me quoque. We must also acknowledge the fact that money is not just a circulating billboard. It functions economically as well as politically and socially. For example, many have complained about the sexism that drove the Susan B. Anthony dollar out of circulation soon after its off-and-on mintage between 1979 and 1999. Some attribute this failure to systemic misogyny, assuming that the coin was rejected solely as the unwelcome intrusion of an historical woman into the heretofore masculine space on American money. The poor reception of the Sacagawea dollar in 2000 may also be noted. One compelling argument often made is that the Anthony dollar looks just like another one in every respect, save one, the portrait of the male, Dwight Eisenhower, instead of a woman. We should remember, however, that the denomination itself may be at fault. Every dollar coin may be doomed to failure for lack of space for it in standard cash drawers. Thus, the Eisenhower dollar fared no better than the Anthony, even though the male version boasted one notable advantage. The Ike dollar was larger and heavier than the diminutive Anthony dollar, leaving the latter virtually indistinguishable from a U.S. quarter. The difference in size between circulating dollars and quarters amounted to only 2.24 millimeters, less than a tenth of an inch. As a result, the Anthony dollar was thrust into direct competition with quarters, which have an indispensable role to play in making change. The only fair test is to experiment with denominations less than a dollar in this monetary battle of the sexes. We easily forget just how many denominations there have been in U.S. monetary history. In my grandson's kindergarten classroom hangs a poster titled Coins, with large cutout pictures labeled penny, nickel, dime, and quarter. The text explains the relative values of each denomination, describes its color, and identifies the president displayed on it. Kids memorize the poster's quotidian math that makes 100 pennies equal to 20 nickels, or 10 dimes, or four quarters. That is the much abridged system of coinage these children have inherited from earlier times, when Americans handled half-cent coppers and three-cent nickels. One can only imagine the number of insights and ironies hidden among the other 220 currencies used in the world today, ranging alphabetically from Afghanistan to Zimbabwe. And that is only the present, which represents just the latest phase of a millennial monetary history that began 2,600 years ago, when the first coins were invented in the late 7th century BC by the enterprising Lydians. Their kingdom lay within Anatolia, modern Turkey, the land of legendary riches associated with King Midas, whose touch turned everything to gold, and Lydia's own King Croesus, whose name became the byword for wealth in the phrase, rich as Croesus. Before coinage, ancient societies measured wealth in land, cattle, and other commodities, allotting social rank and political power accordingly. The spread of coinage shook that world and shaped its future down to our day. The invention of coins fostered both hope and anxiety. Some sang its praises, others sounded alarms. The spread of coinage reconfigured all relationships between landed and landless, farmer and merchant, debtor and creditor, citizen and government, and did so in ways that contributed to other breathtaking revolutions, such as the rise of retail trade, democracy, tragic theater, and Western philosophy. Recognizing this power and resolving to control it, early adopters among the Greeks included Athens, Aegina, and Corinth. The number of Greek states, poleis, operating their own mints eventually climbed to over 400. Each claimed, within its borders, a monopoly on the production of coinage, fearing the consequences of leaving this new technology in private hands. They validated their own currencies and simultaneously expressed their unique civic identities by stamping their coins with distinctive designs called the type, and often an inscription called the legend. By virtue of these types and legends, coins quickly assumed new roles as efficient messengers, passing along key information hand to hand. The designs of ancient coins commemorated historical events, advertised regional products, promoted selected values and religions, showcased military power, and disseminated facsimiles of notable art and architecture. The civic coins of Athens, for example, displayed the patron goddess Athena, the first letters of the city's name, A-T-H-E, the wise owl, still a symbol of learning, and an olive branch, representing the major agricultural export of the region. Thus, in addition to its monetary functions, coinage could copy, store, and deliver data in ways that papyrus, parchment, and paper could not. As tiny mobile disks of information technology in a world lacking other means of mass communication, the earliest coins captured in durable metals the fleeting history of an otherwise forgotten past. Pocket science. Exploring that history remains the purview of many specialists, but one group may be less well known than the others, namely numismatists, experts in the field of numismatics, the study and curation of coins and related monetary objects. The problem is that numismatics, oddly named and rarely taught in schools or universities, has never enjoyed much notice in modern culture. Few people will associate numismatics with coins and other forms of money, and at that, merely in the very restricted sense of a stay-at-home, stuck-in-the-mud collector. Pop culture has yet to fashion from such a creature an equivalent of, say, Indiana Jones or Lara Croft. We follow the adventures of no hero armed with a weaponized magnifying glass and wearing trademark white cotton gloves. No kid comes home from the movies and tells her parents, "I want to be a numismatist when I grow up." If she did, her parents would scramble for a dictionary. They would have no prior knowledge of Queen Christina of Sweden, the Minerva of the North, or of the Countess Charlotte Sophie Bentinck, who were both erudite and liberated numismatists centuries ahead of their time. Numismatics is a noble, if unheralded, discipline, stretching back beyond the Renaissance and deep into antiquity itself. Numismatists were among the first explorers to exhibit those talents now lionized by Hollywood, a heroic capacity for hard work, bravery, intellectual curiosity, a broad knowledge of languages, peoples, and iconography, field experience, and brilliant intuition. Numismatics has at times an astonishing history, animated by real adventures, traipsing through exotic lands, fighting off pirates, enduring capture and torture by hinterland tribes, and at least one case, being hacked to pieces by an angry Afghan mob. Jean-François Valjean, while serving the numismatic passions of King Louis XIV, fell into the hands of Algerian pirates in 1674. To save the 20 gold coins he had collected for the king, Valjean bravely swallowed them. Some of these specimens, after completing a painful journey through the body of the escaped numismatist, can still be seen in the French National Collection today. Captain Arthur Connolly, a British intelligence officer and aspiring numismatist in 19th century Afghanistan, was captured and held prisoner in the dark bowels of the infamous bug pit of Bukhara. Insects and vermin swarming inside the pitiless hole gnawed away at his flesh until he was finally hauled out and beheaded. In 1841, Sir Alexander Burnes ended his diplomatic and numismatic career in Kabul, where he was attacked and dismembered at the outset of the First Afghan War. The imaginary Indiana Jones pales by comparison. And in truth, many of the real archaeologists hero-wise today began their storied careers as numismatists, including Sir William Flinders Petrie, Sir Arthur Evans, Ivor Noel Hume, and Max Mallowan, the husband of mystery writer Agatha Christie. Those who wonder whether cryptocurrencies will someday render numismatics obsolete have missed several key points. Like Greek temples, Mayan pyramids, or medieval castles, coins will always need to be studied, whether the world makes or uses any more of them or not. As long as our history, from 630 BC to today, is worth understanding, which is to say, half of all recorded history, then coins, and those who study them, will be vital to society. Even if, a big if, coins ever do go extinct as daily financial instruments, they will remain important as the historical foundation for our future, and as evidence for our past. There are over 175 museum collections worldwide that strive to document this long numismatic history. One measure of the importance of numismatics can be found in what digital currencies cannot do in our future. As dematerialized and decentralized money, crypto coins speak for no state and take no interest in commemorating or communicating anything of historical value. They retain almost none of the qualities that make traditional coins so vital as repositories of social memory. Humanity knows itself through text and image, knowledge that is quintessentially numismatic. Every savings bank is at the same time a memory bank, so long as the contents include real coins. When learned humanists in the 14th century AD created the Renaissance, they relied heavily upon numismatics. Renaissance men and women studied every numismatic nuance to develop new theories about classical art, architecture, portraiture, and history. In time, they used ancient coins in a scientific way to decipher unknown languages and even to reconstruct the histories of forgotten realms, such as the lost Greek kingdom of Bactria in what is now Afghanistan. By the end of the 19th century, numismatists had identified and analyzed more than 200,000 different varieties of Greek and Roman coinage. These may be added to other mintages of equal importance to world history, such as Chinese, Indian, Muslim, and other more modern currencies. That is a legacy we cannot afford to abandon, least of all in this age of emerging cryptocurrencies that might break the numismatists' long chain of evidence for all the generations to come. The path ahead. For these reasons, the aim of this work is to communicate three important truths to a broad audience, perhaps unfamiliar with numismatics. First, like all forms of money, coins are not simply utilitarian objects. They invite us to think about them not only in economic terms, but also as adjuncts to our cultural, political, artistic, religious, social, and military lives. At its best, numismatics combines the exactitude of science with the significance of history and the excitement of archaeology. We must stretch our minds beyond a mundane world of inanimate objects in order to understand coins as sometimes our masters rather than our minions. Second, numismatics has revealed massive amounts of information about world civilizations that could not be obtained by any other means. The durability and ubiquity of coins have created an ongoing historical record unrivaled by any other medium. Numismatics is not just factual, it is artifactual, and that is an important dimension often lacking in other fields that also study the mysteries of money. Numismatists have been among the greatest contributors to the arts and humanities. Sometimes, however, numismatists have shared with others a prejudiced view of the world that abets the rise of pseudoscience. This kind of error must be rooted out of the discipline by those who are new to it. Third, new ways of thinking about coins will open unexpected avenues for future research as part of the same exciting processes that drive other hard and social sciences. We are far from exhausting what numismatics can tell us about our ancestors and ourselves, nor should we forget about coins as objects worthy of study in their own right. Once we move beyond neglecting coins or even collecting coins, we enter a heightened phase of social and historical consciousness. The chapters that follow will touch upon each of these truths. In doing so, they will also try to situate numismatics in a broader cultural context than is normally acknowledged. The appearance of coins in literature and popular culture will be addressed wherever possible. In Chapter 2, From the Coins' Point of View, we spin off from literature and science a novel way to think about the lives being led by our money. What does the relationship between coins and people look like from a coin's perspective? Are we in charge of money, or is money in charge of us? It will be shown that coins may not think and act, but they do act as though they think, and often to the detriment of their human hosts. We may thank New Ideas About Memes and Object Agency for this unusual glimpse into the extraordinary mind of money. Chapter 3, The Invention of Coins, carries the reader back in time to the world of the ancient Greeks and their neighbors. What did early societies use for money, and why did they eventually mint coins instead? How did this monetary revolution impact the social and political lives of everyday people? Chapter 4, The First Numismatists, examines the interest taken in coined money by ancient and medieval thinkers of note, from Aristotle and Aristophanes to Jesus, Pliny the Elder, and Nicola Orosma. These philosophers, writers, scientists, and theologians laid the groundwork for a later surge in numismatic studies during the Renaissance. Chapter 5, The Second Wave. The rise of antiquarianism in the 14th and 15th centuries fostered a nearly frenetic search for collectible coins by the kings, popes, and princes of Europe. Collectors reclaimed the classical world by amassing private Kunstkammern, cabinets of curiosities, that often featured numismatic collections. Enthusiasm sometimes outpaced intellectual rigor, but the aspirations of numismatics as a disciplined, scientific pursuit eventually prevailed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.